Todd.
Todd.
Rundgren.
Rundgren.
Todd.
Todd.
Rundgren.
Rundgren.
Todd Rundgren.
Todd Rundgren. Bye. That's Todd.
That's the song that you hear right there when I'm in the end zone. After I'm in the end zone, you're going to hear that. Hit it one more time. Oh, see. That's music to our ears right there.
And they just get wild. I mean, obviously, there's a few songs that are kind of staples within Lambo, and that is one of them. And hopefully you hear it more often than not.
Now a prelude to the Lambo Leap, Bang the Drum All Day was written and recorded by eclectic rocker Todd Rundgren.
I'm kind of happy that I've done something that penetrated the consciousness of the culture in this way that everybody knows it.
I'm
because they can't remember where the hell they first heard it.
Rundgren says that he first heard it nearly 30 years ago in a dream.
It just popped into my head pretty much the way it got recorded. And it was kind of a throwaway song on a record of songs that I thought I had worked a lot harder on.
It's just a party song. I mean, Krista, you were there many, many times as a visitor. How was it like? And you heard that played, right?
Oh, yeah. We used to play it in practice, getting ready to go to Lambeau.
Did you?
I mean, that song, Reggie White, Rush of the Passer, Brett Favre, my goodness, that. It also is one of the rare songs that you hear at a stadium. You go play here in New York, you hear Jay-Z or some rap, but it makes the Green Bay and the atmosphere and the crowds really.
Whoa. Mom just caught air. Not that she'll describe it that way to her book club. She'll probably say something like, everyone had a wonderful time. The food was great. It was good to get away.
You know, you crop up in TV shows. Are you ever watching 30 Rock? Or are you ever watching whatever it is, The Office, and they reference you?
I don't want to work. I just want to bang on this mug all day.
Did you ask me here for any specific reason?
I have to tell you that the one that really got me was when I was watching a Beavis and Butthead episode, and I got referenced in that. Now, that was freaky.
Whoa, look at that shoe. Look, high heels.
Yeah. That must mean there's a chick.
Yeah. Or Todd Rundgren.
Who?
Todd Rundgren.
Who the hell is he, Beavis?
You don't know who Todd Rundgren is?
No. And you don't either.
Oh, yeah.
We had done a number of concept albums that we built big shows around, and we had toured those and had built a pretty good audience. And I think we got to a point after doing these records with Bearsville, we decided that we would try a slightly different tack because we had a new label, a new approach, and they were ready to really get behind us. So we decided to, you know, to try and make a pop record.
Better stay away from Libertine.
Stay away from Libertine.
Stay away from Libertine.
Stay away from
Libertine. Sylvia's latest album release is unique in that it is, as they call it, a three-sided album.
It turned out to be not as difficult, I guess, as we thought, because we went up in an album and a half's worth of material. It would only have been a CD's worth nowadays, but in those days it was 15 or 16 songs. And so they got the idea to put out an album and a half. Probably our best reviewed album. Stereo Review gave it its featured five-star review that month or whatever, the full page. It said, this is the perfect pop album, blah, blah, blah. Unfortunately, immediately after the album came out, just as these things always seem to happen throughout the career of Utopia, Elektra, who was the distributor of Network Records, decided to close their New York office, which was where Network had been situated. So essentially the record went right through the cracks, like like so many of our other records, and never did had you know, anything like the string of hits that it possibly could have had.
With the record company, we steadily got less and less money for each record that we would start, probably because the last record hadn't sold enough, and so we were mortgaged all the time.
As our relationship with Bearsville ended and we had to get into more independent sort of deals, we didn't get the tour support anymore, so we couldn't go out and start building big things and renting trucks to haul them around, and we started to have to work more or less within our immediate means.
See that we were bringing in influences from all over the place. So I always thought that that was both the strong point and, in a way, the downfall of the band. The band's musical interests and its ability to actually perform all these different styles was capable. And so we tended to, you know, just kind of go all over the map musically, you know, unlike, you know, other bands which were, you know, sticking to their whatever, their heavy metal theme or whatever it was they were doing. The record company never knew what they were going to get from us.
Todd and Willie always butted heads, you know, and they always were at odds about what direction the band should go in or what we should be doing, what we shouldn't be doing. Roger was kind of leaned a little bit more towards Todd's side. And myself, I had a solo career that I was working on at that time. And so I was like, you know, you guys battle it out. I'm easy. I'll just go whatever way you want. Maybe I should have opened my mouth a little bit more. But I just, you know, at that time, I just thought, you know what? I'll let the big guys battle it out. We'll be right back.
You know, I think the diversity, like I say, I think the diversity was both a strength and maybe a drawback commercially. But fans loved it. I mean, they could see the thread of the core of you know, the ideas, like, going throughout that.
Well, the POV record was probably the record that I had the most contribution on, because I wrote half the record and co-produced it with Todd. And of course, there was a lot of friction around that album, but it happens to be the record that I was the most involved in. I mean, I wrote a lot in a lot of the other records, but that would be the record that I contributed the most to.
Utopia always had a commitment to play whatever it is we did live in the studio. And many of our records, particularly in the early days of Utopia, we would have played substantially on the road before we got to the studio. We were just about being a live band. And the, you know, the downfall or the germ that eventually ate away at the band was when we stopped doing that. When we started using synthesizers and sequencers too much. And when we finally got to our last studio album, which was POV, Willie wasn't even playing the drums anymore. He was programming all the drums. And so we were obviously not playing live any longer. And it just made it, for me, it made it no fun, because I could always do that stuff myself. As time went on, it's the same thing that happens with everyone. Your audience just tends to shrink. You get replaced by more trendy bands like Flock of Seagulls or something. You know.
I know our last show, I think, was at Universal Amphitheater in L.A. I think that was the very last show. And I remember that being sad. We knew that it was our last show. It's kind of one of those things where you knew it was time to break up. You knew you should break up. Breaking up was so hard to do. Finally, we just made the decision. We had worked so hard. And I think we should have been more commercially successful than we were. And there's a number of things that contributed to that. But just the accumulation of punches at that point really rendered us, you know, to make the decision that, you know, we just need to stop. And so we did. But it wasn't really like, stop, fuck you, fuck you, fuck you, see you later. It wasn't really, you know, we weren't upset. It just, we were exhausted, I think, you know, collectively exhausted. We tried for a long, long time to make that band be able to take care of itself financially and be successful. In the process, we made a lot of great music, but it was time to stop. I mean, it just, that was the end.
We just had a hell of a time, I mean, a good time, you know, making these records, because we could essentially do anything we wanted. The whole idea was to try to do something, you know, different and inspirational and creative.
We had a great time. We had really, really fun times. We would laugh and we did a lot of stupid things together.
You know, the quality of the music and the general musicianship, because to this day I still get people coming up and saying, you know, and not really people who are fans, like saying, you changed, you know, our life with your music, which I still do hear, which is really nice. But I think the thing that as a musician that I appreciate is that I still bump into musicians, and many of them famous musicians, come up and say, you know, I love Utopia. You guys are such a great band. And so there was a lot of respect amongst other musicians for this band.
I'm very happy and glad to have been a part of it. I mean, I feel like what I've done and, you know, what the band did and what we did collectively, individually, does represent, you know, if you look back at the, quote, history of rock and roll for that period of time, I think we were probably one of the more interesting creative bands.
In an effort to stay progressively ahead of his peers, Todd Rundgren has just released Acapella, his most unique album yet. The entire album was recorded with just two instruments, Todd Rundgren's voice and a sophisticated digital sampling device called the emulator.
This on the album goes something like this. Get a microphone, put it into sample mode. Ooh. Put a sample of sound in it. That's what it looks like. You picture it. And then you can play the sampled sound. This is where I sampled it at. Ooh, ooh. So you get some idea what it sounds like. What you hear is my voice digitally encoded into bits and bytes and stored inside the instrument, and it will now play it anywhere on the keyboard that I place my hand.
It was an album concept I had for a while, but the technology hadn't really come around to make it practical to try.
So when the first samplers came out, I made the a cappella album.
Most other artists have engineers and producers, people to make sure they don't go too far in a specific direction that may hurt them. Are you afraid that could happen to you?
No.
After a while, I got kind of tired of just being up there by myself, so started evolving through a more ensemble phase that began with a cappella. I took 11 singers out, and that was great, and that kind of, you know, my audience liked that. You know, they liked the material in that particular thing.
I love.
Once there was a boy and a girl. The boy said, I love you so. Girl said, I'll never leave. They grew older and left each other. That's the way love goes. That's the way love goes. And then there's a child. It seems like you'll never find someone willing to love. Keep on looking, you soon discover a mighty love. Sometimes make a weak man more than a mighty love. Sit all day by the telephone, 'cause you're all alone. You need a mighty love. Some say that you're drunk to find love and peace of mind. At the end of the rainbow, there's no sign in the sky to follow.
That's the way love goes,
baby.
That's the way love goes.
It's all as a ride. Says I well can be fine. Love is just what you make. Keep on loving, you soon discover a mighty love.
You're also on tour now, sort of a small tour.
Well, it's a solo tour.
And this is a compilation of all your work?
More or less, yeah. It's Rhino Records is a record label. It's picked up all of my past catalog, and they're releasing between now and Christmas about 18 albums and CDs and
That'd
stuff.
That'd be great to have.
By full box set.
Yeah. You said you're working with Pee Wee Herman?
I'm doing some music for his Saturday morning kids show. I've been asked by Michael Mann to do the score.
scoring for Police Story.
Well, it's his new television show.
Yeah.
Yeah, terrific.
I saw you in Letterman. You were talking about the film soundtracks you were doing, whatever, right?
Yeah, I did some TV. I did Crime Story and Pee Wee's Playhouse.
Yeah. Is that different? It's quite a different thing for you than doing
it? Yeah, it's different, and they're different from each other.
I was approached by someone from the New York Shakespeare Festival. That's Joseph Papp's organization in New York. And they had acquired the rights to produce a stage play, or musical as it turned out, of a screenplay that Joe Orton had written to be the Beatles' third movie. We talked about it a little bit, and I decided to do it. I decided also not to do it as imitation Beatles, but to do it as I would do it.
Musical now, and it's one of the more satisfying things I've been involved in, not only from the standpoint of it being something that I've always wanted to do and now have an opportunity to do, but also from the standpoint of the fact that it seems I have a special aptitude for it.
We're free! We're male!
We're 21!
When we were doing Up Against It, there was like some days when I would have to stand in for people during the rehearsals, you know, and actually sing the songs.
I just made 21, I'm old enough to run, a congressman, a clerk of the public works, a dog catcher or something just as dumb, if I should choose to run. I make no exaggeration, just a statement of the facts. Now I'm second generation, and I am manly to the max.
So I'm a Broadway kind of guy.
There's got to be a God, cause he may be male at 21.
The new album, the title of which is Nearly Human, was recorded under what might be considered nowadays unusual circumstances, although 25 years ago it was more or less the norm. I decided to record everything live in the studio without overdubs because in listening to much of contemporary music, there was something missing for me. There was a great dependence on machines, sequencers, and synthetically generated music, and I was missing a certain performance element. So I decided to do the album
entirely live in the studio.
What would you tell me if I could hear you speaking? If you could touch me, how would I know the feeling? I just can't imagine, but I try to do it anyway. I wish I was moving fast. I wish you'd drift back, but it just wasn't meant to happen. Very soon I'll have to face the fact. Some things never come together. Parallel lines wounding you forever. And you can't turn back. There is never any starting.
The procedure was that I would have the various musicians, anywhere from 8, 10 to up to 30 musicians, come into the studio, and we would spend a few hours getting sounds and learning the song. And then I would go off work with background singers for an hour or so, come back and put the singers and the players together, and we would rehearse a little bit more, and then we'd start recording. A lot of the people on the album were people that I had worked with before. Members of Utopia showed up on a sort of surprise session. I didn't know they were going to be there, but someone else contacted them, unbeknownst to me, and managed to get everyone in the same place at the same time for us to do a song together. It was the first time we'd all been in the same room together for probably 5 years, and it was really a buzz. One of a Nail was one of the first songs that I wrote, and I'd always had it in mind to make it sort of a duet, not a full duet, but there were certain parts of the song in which there was an answer, sort of an overlapping vocal part, and I wanted someone who had a voice that had some distinctiveness that was recognizable but different from my own. And so I made up a list of singers. And as it turned out, one of the people on the list, Bobby Womack, actually did perform the song.
No one to love you.
I was getting big in Japan, and that was great. We returned Japan every year, you know, and I was able to take, you know, like a 12-piece with the horns, the background singers, and everything to Japan and all around the States. Let me give you a little introductory wrappage here. I hope that it's been made clear in the press and when you bought your tickets, somebody gave you a warning that this is not a show in the traditional sense. This is a recording session.
In other words, you are participating in a recording session, so we are not so much obligated to entertain you as to as you are to help us create what will ultimately be a record, we hope. Let me clarify the distinction between a recording session and a show. In a show, we might we would play every song once, and no matter how bad we played it, we would play it from beginning to end, and then go on to the next song, and kind of like try and forget how badly we played it once we had done that. In this particular context, if we start playing a song badly, then we have to stop it and start it over again, because there's no point in just going through the song for the exercise. We're trying to make a record. Wake up crying like I cry. What's the problem? There's no problem in your own little world. What's the bother? Can't be bothered. The reason why you're here is because in a normal studio setting, we would be playing the music, and then that would go onto a machine, and then it would get mixed, and then 6 months later or so, the audience at large would get to hear it, and that would sort of complete the loop of performer to listener. And we wanted to sort of close up that loop so that we can feel not like we're playing to a machine, but that we're playing to people. And coincidentally, you happen to be people. The ground rules are slightly different as well for you. Now being almost part of the performance, the ground rules will be different. We are not seeking to make what is commonly referred to as a live album. That is an album where you go out and you play the songs, and it's just like the listener is in the audience. We want this to sound like a studio album. Show it, even though the world is watching while I squirm.
Understands the spell. that's the session.
After that, my relationship with major labels kind of came to an end. I started to think of things to do that involved computers that the labels didn't understand at all, but yet they wanted to own. And so I kind of went to Warner Brothers and said, you know, I've only got one more album that I owe you, and you don't want to pay me the advance for it, so we'll just end it here. And from that point on, I would make the records myself and then find distributorship for it and then go out and flog them on the road.